Let me begin by wishing everyone a happy new year. Today is the year of the rooster. And that seems apt in terms of our national politics. In terms of our grand round schedule, next week, third of February, the lecturer is Brandon Court from Duke University. Continuing our theme of trauma, mental health care responses to the Nepal earthquakes, from humanitarian emergencies to sustainable mental health systems. And then the following week on the 10th is a rescheduling of Grand Rounds that was planned before. Hannah Harvey is going to come to talk about writing about people with mental illness, stories for treatment and research in mental health. It's always a fun and interesting Grand Rounds. So I'm going to introduce Steve Southwick, who's going to introduce our speaker, but I do want to welcome our speaker, Sonia Norman, who is a member of what I call the National Center of PTSD Families. So as some of you may know, in the late 1980s, the VA decided to recreate an entity called the National Center on PTSD. And this was the first essentially serious large-scale academic enterprise ever in the field to address the problem of psychological trauma. That the problems of the returning veterans provided finally for VA a backstop to create a major initiative focused on PTSD. It was the first major initiative focused on PTSD in the entire world and became a model for national centers on PTSD developed in Australia and various other countries. And it has been an unbelievable success. This consortium, which was awarded to White River Junction under the leadership of Matt Friedman as the head of this consortium. And at the time, Dennis Charney headed the Clinical Neuroscience Division here at Yale. The Health Services Division of the center was also at Yale, initiated under the leadership of Bob Rosenheck, now Ronnie Hoff. And the Behavioral Sciences Division was created in Boston under the leadership of Terry Keene. A division on initially clinical laboratory, but now education and PTSD was created at Stanford at the Palo Alto VA. A women's division created in Boston, initially under the leadership of Patty Rizik. And a Pacific Island division in Honolulu. And so what do you get out of such a large and distributed consortium? What you get is the key assessment tool, the CAPS, the gold standard assessment for PTSD. You get from our division the first biological mechanisms implicated in the neurobiology of post-traumatic stress disorder. Out of the Boston divisions, you got cognitive processing therapy, one of the two main therapies for the behavioral or psychotherapeutic treatment of PTSD. And so on and so on, which is that bringing people together in teams creates the opportunity to have a bigger impact than any one part, any one person could have on their own. And that notion of team science, of bringing people together, is really something that we treasure in this department. And one of the reasons that Grand Rounds in general is so important, that we come together and in different ways, we meet our colleagues, we learn what they're doing, and then we figure out how what we do links up to what other people are doing, and coming together in that kind of collaboration is just tremendously productive and tremendously rewarding. So today we have the opportunity to welcome one of our National Center for PTSD Family, I see that all the seats are filled. There are a couple of scattered seats still. The steps are open if you want to sit on the steps for folks who are standing in the hallway. At this point, I will introduce Steve Southwick to introduce our speaker today.
Well, good morning. It's my great pleasure to introduce Sonia Norman, our Grand Rounds speaker. And the title of her talk really says it all, Double Trouble. Just as an aside, I have two cats that look exactly the same from the same litter, and their names are Double and Trouble also. But in this case, it's Double Trouble, Treating PTSD and Substance Use Disorder. Now, as we all know, this is a very important and complex topic. Living with PTSD by itself is extremely challenging, but when you throw in comorbid substance use, you have an almost impossible situation. And yet, these two disorders commonly co-occur. From a therapeutic standpoint, this is an enormous challenge. Do you treat the substance use first before treating PTSD? Do you treat the two disorders simultaneously? In fact, this is such a challenge that years ago, the Veterans Administration rolled out what they called SUPT specialty clinics for the treatment of patients with PTSD and substance use. And Bonnie Becker, who many of you know, and whose husband is John Crystal, was one of our first SUPT directors at the West Haven VA. And this is not an easy job. In fact, it takes a lot of patience, dedication, clinical skills, and quite honestly, courage to work with this group of individuals. Today, Sonia is talking about treating this often toxic combination of PTSD and substance use, and she is a true leader in the field, this field that is so important with regard to clinical research and treatment. Dr. Norman graduated from Vassar College, and she got her master's degree in clinical psychology at the University of Rhode Island and her PhD at Stanford University. She's currently associate professor of psychiatry at University of California, San Diego. She's published extensively in the scientific literature with a focus on PTSD, traumatic stress, as it relates to functional impairment, intimate partner violence, chronic pain, and substance use disorders. Currently, her primary areas of research and funding are in psychotherapies, evidence-based psychotherapies, that treat PTSD, substance use, and post-traumatic guilt. Now, I have to tell you that yesterday, Sonia presented to our research PTSD research group on a treatment that she has developed for trauma-related guilt. We had an extremely lively conversation, and I asked Sonia if she wouldn't mind slipping in a few of her guilt slides into this talk, because it's any clinician who's treated PTSD soon understands that guilt and shame are at the heart of emotional suffering for trauma survivors. I'm not sure how Dr. Norman is able to publish so much because she has another job, which is basically a full-time job with the National Center, and she directs the PTSD consultation program of the National Center, and this program provides consultation to mental health providers throughout the VA. And over the past several years, her program has responded to over 5,000 requests for consultation, and it's been so successful that in 2013, it was expanded to provide consultation to clinicians, non-VA clinicians, who are treating veterans. And requests, that means that clinicians here in the audience can use this consultation who are treating PTSD trauma survivors. And requests for consultation typically come from psychiatrists, psychologists, social workers, nurses. As John said, today we welcome our friend and colleague from the National Center, Sonia. She tackles some of the most challenging areas in our field. And what's very impressive to me is that Sonia is one of those unusual and rare individuals who can take her clinical expertise and wisdom and translate that into evidence-based treatments for people who are suffering with PTSD. So welcome, Sonia.
Thank you so much. I'll let you in on a little secret, which is that when those of us who live in San Diego get invitations to travel north this time of year, we think long and hard before we say yes. But I did not hesitate for a second. It is such an honor to be here and such an honor to have time to meet with our National Center colleagues and to present to all of you. So thank you for having me. So what I'll talk about today is first just give some background to set the stage for the prevalence of co-occurring PTSD and substance use disorder, and then talk a little bit about the research on correlates of associated problems of PTSD and substance use disorder, and really go through some of our studies that have helped paint the picture of what it means to have this comorbidity and exactly some of the struggles that this group is having. And then turn to treatments, both where we are, what we know, which as you'll see is surprisingly modest, and then really where we need to go. I'm gonna refer a lot to the work of Drs. Minnie Petrakis because she's been such a leader in this field, and some of our work as well. So prevalence, if you go to an SUD treatment program, it seems like about half the people have PTSD, quite a bit more than that, have trauma exposure and maybe subsyndromal symptoms of PTSD. This is kind of a conglomerate of a few different studies, but if you go to a PTSD treatment program, you'll find a third to half have substance use disorder in some settings, and in some samples it's higher than that. This is VA data over the last decade, and what I want to show here is that across alcohol use, drug use, and people who have both an alcohol and another substance use disorder, the slope is going up. More people who have PTSD also have at least one of those SUDs. And then if we look at the breakout of SUDs, what's interesting is you could see the slope is increasing most for cannabis and for opioids, which if you think about, this is among veterans, but if you think about the broader landscape of what's happening with medical marijuana and cannabis legalization and the opioid epidemic that we hear so much about, then that these two have the biggest slope, isn't that surprising, right? So some of the correlates that we're seeing across the literature is that people who have both, as opposed to either just PTSD or just a substance use disorder, tend to have worse treatment outcomes. I'll talk about that more later. They have more other comorbidities, psychiatric, medical, all sorts of problems. They don't function as well at work. They have more legal problems, higher HIV risk, poorer social support, higher risk of suicide, and that's something we've looked at in a number of ways, and I'll share some of that work with you. They're more likely to experience more trauma, and they have a higher risk of being aggressive. In fact, I'll say one more thing about the aggression, because I'm not showing any studies on that today, but it's one of the, I think, as we all know in mental health, one of the biggest areas of stigma for people with mental health problems is this idea that they'll be aggressive or violent. And when we look at that relationship between PTSD and aggression, we do see a correlation, but often when we control for things like substance use and other kind of functional stressors, that correlation is no longer significant. So that role of alcohol is really important there. So my research goals have been really to delve deeper into this relationship between substance use disorder and PTSD, and understand the why and the how, and why are the outcomes worse. And then in my heart of hearts, I'm a treatment researcher, so I like to do psychotherapy trials, and I'll walk you through some of where we are and where we're heading. And that's what we'll focus on today. So I'm gonna go through three studies of kind of these associated problems. The first is about medical problems, the second is about suicide, and the third is about guilt, and the third I added last night at Steve Southwick's request. So this is a paper we published almost a decade ago now, looking at health problems of substance-dependent veterans with and without a trauma history. This is at the San Diego VA. So we know from a large body of literature that having an alcohol use disorder or other substance use disorders is associated with many chronic health problems over time, liver disease, cardiovascular disease, cancer, STDs. And we know that trauma history and PTSD are also associated with chronic health problems. They seem to elevate the likelihood of arthritis, respiratory diseases, nervous diseases, digestive, cardiac diseases. And Paula Schnurr, another one of our National Center colleagues, came up with a model for why there might be this relationship between trauma and physical health that we've then further evaluated, which is that it's not so much experiencing trauma that leads to these health problems, but that there's all these processes that occur between the trauma and this elevated risk of morbidity and mortality. So one, it's the burden of the PTSD symptoms, if they're having symptoms. And two, all these other processes that this seems to trigger. So for example, we know that people with PTSD symptoms are likely to have biological alterations in the HPA axis, noradrenergic function, immune functioning, and also psychological alterations. PTSD symptoms are often associated with depression, anxiety, those are kind of core to some of the symptoms, poor coping, sometimes dissociation. And then we also know that they tend not to take very good care of themselves sometimes. So actually in DSM-5, one of the new symptoms is taking part in high-risk behaviors that can be dangerous and lead to exposure to illness or injury. Or perhaps because of avoidance, they're not going to the doctor, they're not taking good care of themselves. We know there's attentional processes, so there might be altered perception or mislabeling of physical symptoms. And we know that having PTSD symptoms can alter utilization of health services and reports and functional status. So then you take trauma exposure, you take that, we know there's this elevated risk of morbidity and mortality, and all these processes may be accounting for some of that. And so we wanted to kind of ask, why are we, how do we put that all together to think about why we're seeing this relation, this sort of increased relationship with health problems with substance use and trauma and PTSD. And a theory that's really kind of beautiful in simplicity is the theory of allostatic load, which is that just as an organism goes through more cycles of stress or experiences more stress, it gets more tired. It sort of wears down by adapting to this stress. And ultimately, this leads to susceptibility of illness. So based on these two models I presented, we looked at the sample of individuals who'd been through, who came in presenting with an SUD, wanting treatment for their substance use disorder. And we speculated that the ones who had substance use only would have the fewest chronic health problems, utilize treatment the least, and rate their health the highest, relative to people who had substance use disorder and a trauma history and maybe some symptoms but not full-blown PTSD, and that people who had full-blown PTSD and a substance use disorder, based on this theory of having the heaviest allostatic load, would have the most chronic health problems, the most utilization, and the lowest health ratings. So these were males admitted to the VA San Diego Alcohol Drug Treatment Program. They had to have used in the last 90 days. We interviewed them about symptoms and substance use at baseline. This was not a treatment study, so they went on to do any number of treatments, not anything specific, not anything we randomized them to. And we followed them for 1 year. So they came in a baseline, and then we followed them quarterly for 1 year. And what the way they fell out at these baseline interviews is that 55 had a substance use disorder only, 34 had substance use and trauma history, and 32 had full-blown PTSD. The majority had an alcohol use disorder, and then we also saw cannabis use disorder and stimulants, and that obviously doesn't add up to 100% because many had more than one. And at the end, what we saw was that about 33% of the substance use disorder only group was abstinent, 35 of the trauma group, and actually 47 of the PTSD group. And not surprisingly, the PTSD group had about twice the severity of trauma-related symptoms as the trauma but not PTSD group. And their trauma experiences were similar, other than that the PTSD group was more likely to have been in combat. So getting to our results, it fell out surprisingly consistently with our hypotheses, where the red bar is the PTSD group, and they had, across every time point, the most chronic health difficulties, the highest allostatic load. The trauma group was in the middle, and the no trauma, no PTSD group was lowest. And I was actually happy to see that this was relatively stable over time, because we're measuring chronic illnesses. So if they had changed much quarter to quarter, that would have given me concern about, you know, the reliability of the data. When we looked at treatment utilization, we saw that the trauma exposed in the PTSD groups were significantly higher than the substance use only group. This was no longer significant in the final quarters, and it kind of looks to me like they met in the middle, that maybe the low utilization SUD only group is maybe using services more appropriately and going a little more, and the trauma exposed groups are maybe using services a little more appropriately and going a little less, and they're kind of meeting in the middle. In terms of health ratings, what I was interested in is what percent mark their health as excellent or very good. This is baseline data. And that's the dark gray and the blue. If you look at SUD only, that's almost 3/4 of the pie said their health was excellent or very good. If you look at those who were trauma exposed, it's less than half. And if you look at the PTSD group, it's just over 1/4. So as that allostatic load increases, they're less and less likely to say that their health is excellent or very good. So our hypotheses were really supported here. And I think a lot of support for both this allostatic load model and this model that I showed you of Paula Schnurr's, really suggesting that it's not just the trauma exposure, but there's all these processes when you bring in PTSD symptoms and the biological changes and such that are likely contributing to this heightened load. And it really suggests in this comorbid population that we should be taking maybe a dimensional approach and not only looking at sort of full-blown diagnosis, but sort of post-traumatic distress in possibly a number of ways. So to change gears a little bit now, I'll share a more recent study where we looked at suicide ideation in veterans who'd served in Iraq and Afghanistan. And this doesn't sound on the surface like a PTSD substance use disorder story, but in fact it is, because we know that those things contribute. And those are PTSD and depression are probably the two factors that have been looked at the most in relation to suicidal ideation. But a couple of studies are suggesting that reintegration stress is also really challenging and could contribute. So this is, you know, someone's been in the military for 2 years, maybe more than that, and now they're separating, they're back in their community, they're trying to reintegrate into civilian life, reintegrate into their families, go back to school or get a job, take care of their kids. And we know that that can be very difficult and very stressful for some people. And about 40% of combat veterans report some to extreme difficulty readjusting to civilian life. So we wanted to look at whether reintegration difficulties contribute to SI even when we control for PTSD symptoms and depression symptoms and substance misuse. And then because this is a newer area, we actually wanted to look at what types of reintegration difficulties, kind of item by item. And we had data on 232 veterans who were seeking PTSD treatment who had served in Iraq or Afghanistan. And we gave them Nina Sayer's Military to Civilian Reintegration Questionnaire. And we looked at the suicidal ideation item of the PHQ-9, which is a self-report depression measure, and a self-report PTSD scale, and a screen for substance misuse. Reintegration stress contributed to SI over and above depression symptoms, over and above PTSD symptoms significantly. But here's what was most interesting and kind of most relevant to the topic of our talk today, is that when you added substance misuse to the model, substance use and reintegration stress interacted such that the likelihood of having SI was 5 times greater in people who had both than in people who only had the reintegration stress without the substance misuse. So as I mentioned, we decided to look at the scale item by item to see what it could tell us. And although, you know, this is very preliminary work, I wouldn't hang my hat on, you know, sort of single item analyses, I just thought this was interesting and worth sharing. Here's the items that were significant out of 16. Difficulty keeping up with military friendships. Difficulty getting along with family. Difficulty feeling like you belong in civilian society. And difficulty finding meaning or purpose in life. Right? So even though this is a sample of recently separated veterans, if you think about what makes life worth living, it's connection to friends and family, right? It's feeling a sense of belonging in your community, in your world, and it's feeling a sense of meaning in your life. So these felt much broader to me than just maybe what's relevant to this particular sample. So I think this this highlights the importance both of reintegration stress if you're working with this particular population, but also, again, bringing us back around to that relationship between PTSD and substance use disorder. It just sort of shows how these other contributing factors kind of complicate the scenario and how we have to look broader at what's going on in life, and reintegration, meaning in life, all these kinds of things become relevant. I'll also talk now about just a little sliver of our work on guilt. I won't get into our treatment, which I presented on yesterday, but we've also been trying to build a picture, build a narrative around trauma-related guilt and what it means for people who've been through trauma in terms of their other symptoms and psychopathology and ability to recover. And In this particular study that I'll share with you, we looked at substance misuse. And so guilt related to trauma is really common following trauma and combat. And as you probably know, in DSM-5, it's actually now noted as a symptom. So it's not, you know, before I went into PTSD, you know, I think we've all heard of survivor guilt, and I thought maybe that was the extent of it. And in fact, now I think we're seeing that it's much more prevalent than that, and it's not even just a veteran issue in our DSM-5 work, much of which has been done here. We're really seeing a high prevalence of this symptom across people with all different trauma types. And if you think about someone who was in a car accident and was the driver and others got hurt, might feel a great sense of guilt. I've worked with a lot of women who've been through intimate partner violence who will say have a great deal of guilt because of what their children saw or for other reasons. So it's really common across trauma types. And we know that it can exacerbate various forms of post-traumatic distress. So if you've been through a trauma, you may have be upset about any number of things. If you're also feeling guilty, that distress overall is amplified. The research on whether if someone has a presentation of PTSD where they feel guilty about the trauma, how that affects treatment is kind of mixed. Some studies suggest that the treatments we have work well, and some studies suggest that it's harder to treat people when they have guilt on board. We need more research there. But we do know from a study with World War II veterans conducted in the 90s that guilt can persist for upwards of 40 years if not addressed. So some of the work that we're finding and others are finding who are looking at post-traumatic guilt, it is both a risk factor for developing post-traumatic stress disorder, as well as seems to be associated with more severe symptom profiles, similar with depression post-trauma, and seems to partially mediate that relationship between combat exposure and experiencing PTSD and depression. It seems relevant to alcohol use disorder, post-trauma, and suicidal ideation. And as a first step in our own work, we started asking veterans, this was about a decade ago, if they endorsed guilt, what they were feeling guilty about. And again, this kind of shattered all my beliefs around, like, well, there's survivor guilt or survivor guilt. In fact, the kind of guilt they felt was incredibly varied, incredibly nuanced, incredibly individuated. Killing is another one that maybe is sometimes kind of obvious, and often with our research, we'll get a referral from a clinician and interview the person and see there's no guilt there. And we'll go back to the clinician and say, why did you send us this person? And they'll say, well, they killed someone. They told me they killed someone in the interview, so I sent them to your guilt study. Turns out that's a big leap that many people in the understand that that's something that happens in the context of war, and it doesn't present a great deal of guilt for them or guilt at all. But for some it does, and for some what we've discovered, it's not the killing, but it's something in that process, like, I enjoyed it. or I felt a rush and I wanted to do more of it in that moment. What does that say about me? It must mean that I'm a monster. It must mean that I'm a horrible person. So that guilt can be really nuanced in terms of what it's referring to. There's also a lot around failing to act, freezing, believing they should have saved the day and didn't, which in our treatment we often discover is they really didn't have this power. They've been telling themselves that they should have had. So in this particular study, we looked at the relationship between trauma-related guilt and screening positive for substance use problems. And we hypothesized that trauma-related guilt would be associated with substance misuse above and beyond PTSD and depression symptoms. This was kind of a preliminary analysis, and we now have a bigger sample, and we're going to look at this again, so this isn't published. This was with 127 male combat veterans presenting for PTSD treatment. And based on their intake, about 80% did meet PTSD, and about 8% met for substance use disorder. And we gave them the trauma-related guilt inventory, which is in regard to guilt related to a trauma, and a PTSD, depression, and drug screen measure. And what we found is even when we controlled for PTSD symptoms and depression, that guilt cognitions still increased the risk of screening positive for drug use problems. So again, we're seeing that it's not just the PTSD sort of, you know, they're not just self-medicating, it's not just about the PTSD symptoms. There's these other things contributing. In this case, it's guilt cognition specifically, which is, I should have been able to stop what happened. I shouldn't have done what I did. I messed up. It was my fault that things went the way they did. Those are the kinds of guilt cognitions that are then contributing to them using substances. And this is very much in line with what I see clinically and what got me interested into the subject to begin with, because I find when someone has guilt and shame related to their trauma, there's almost the sense of, I don't deserve to get better because of what I did. I should be suffering. And so it's not surprising to me that they're using drugs, that they're sort of sending themselves down this downward spiral. So we did find that guilt, greater trauma-related guilt was associated with greater substance use problems. And personally, I think it's pretty important to be screening for this kind of guilt or for trauma-related guilt and understanding exactly what these cognitions are and how we can help people who are struggling with guilt. So at this point, this is kind of in the piece of the talk on some of the associated problems and complexities of having PTSD and a substance use disorder. We've looked at health problems, we've looked at suicide, we've looked at guilt, we've looked at reintegration. And clearly that's just, you know, scratching the surface. And that's just three studies that we have done in my lab, and you know, there's many of us who are doing many more. So we see really the complex and sort of multiple mechanisms potentially involved, and I think that becomes really relevant as we turn to treatment, because one thing we know is it's hard to treat this comorbidity. People drop out, people don't do well, people cycle through treatment many times, and so I think this just is sort of a hint at how much we need to step back and integrate into our conceptualization of this challenging population to really think about where we're going in treating them. So let me turn now to treatment, and I'll start by giving a little history. So traditionally, treatment for PTSD and substance use disorder was sequential, with substance use disorder coming first. The thought was that people who were using, you really couldn't maybe even treat other, at that time, Axis I disorders. You didn't even know if they were real until the person was abstinent for some length of time. And that, you know, I think we still struggle with that, but historically that might have been enough reason to sort of say, well, we won't even look at those other symptoms until they're abstinent, which we no longer do. And also with PTSD specifically, this idea that pointing people toward their trauma, many people might be too vulnerable for that, especially people who are using substance use disorder. If you ask them to look at their trauma, the clinical beliefs were that they weren't ready. You might make them worse. They might relapse. Their other symptoms might become worse. They might become suicidal. You just shouldn't go there until they're abstinent and stronger. And this translated very rigidly in clinical practice. When I first started at the VA in San Diego, the way the consult to the PTSD program was written was, have they been abstinent for 6 months? And there was a checkbox. And if you didn't check that checkbox, that consult was just rejected. It wasn't even reviewed. So it was pretty rigid. And then thankfully, there was some policy change in about a decade ago where we're no longer able to do that. And partly that's from an understanding, as the research has developed, that people can handle PTSD treatment even if they're using, and that in fact it actually helps their treatment. So what we do know, though, is that people who have both disorders relapse more quickly. PTSD can predict relapse, especially if they're not treated. And in one interesting study by Denise Hien in New York, remission of PTSD was associated with better SUD outcomes as treatment went on, but remission of a substance use disorder was not associated with improved PTSD. So it sort of flips that lore on its head and says, actually, if you treat the PTSD, they're more likely to benefit from the SUD treatment, not less likely. But having said that, we have these very effective PTSD treatments. As Dr. Crystal referred to, you know, a lot of this work came from National Center. We're in such a good place relative to where we were 20 years ago with PTSD treatment. And yet, and what we see is that these treatments are effective but less effective when people are using substances. We have a long way to go to figure out how do we make those treatments as effective, or should we be looking in other directions as well. So my primary area is psychotherapy research, and so I'll briefly describe a meta-analysis to kind of bring you up to date on the psychotherapy research literature for PTSD and substance use disorder comorbidity, and then sort of use that as a launching pad for the research that we're doing now. So the Cochrane group did this meta-analysis that was published last year, 2015, and they searched literature up to January 10th, 2014, and they identified 14 studies. They only included studies that specifically recruited for the comorbidity, so not, you know, a PTSD treatment study that happened to have some people who also had a substance use disorder, but actually studies that were only included people who had both. And across the 14 studies, the meta-analysis included over 1,400 participants. And their main comparison was, basically, across the 14 studies, they found that about half used a trauma processing kind of exposure-based treatment, generally prolonged exposure or some variant of it, and about half the studies used a coping skills therapy, where there was no trauma processing, but people just worked on coping better now. So I'll explain more about that. So the trauma processing studies, many used PE or sort of a modified PE, prolonged exposure. So in PE, it's a 12-week usually plus or minus protocol, and there's a few, the main goal of it is to help people confront situations they've been avoiding. The idea of PE is that many people in their lifetime experience a life-threatening traumatic event. Most do not go on to develop PTSD. The ones who do tend to be more avoidant. They avoid thinking about the trauma memory. They avoid the feelings that it brings up for them. So maybe they haven't processed that pain or that fear or that grief or that guilt. They avoid people, places, things that remind them of the trauma, so their life becomes really restricted. And so the goal of the therapy is really to turn that around and have them reclaim these memories and these activities that are objectively safe but don't feel safe to them because they remind them of the trauma. And so the treatment does that by educating clients about this model, and then imaginal exposure where they talk about the trauma memory over and over but in a safe environment. It feels dangerous, but it's not. And then they listen to a recording of themselves talking about it. And then they make a hierarchy of things they've been avoiding, and they go out and do those things, kind of with the idea of learning through experience that, oh, in fact, I can handle this, and it's not as dangerous as I've been telling myself. And what we see with PE is that people who start with PTSD 100%, over 70% no longer have PTSD after treatment. And that actually gets better and better after 5-10 years later, those are lasting effects of PE. So what did the Cochrane Group find in those about 7 studies that looked at trauma-focused treatments for people who had both PTSD and a substance use disorder? For PTSD symptoms, the trauma-focused treatment, the exposure treatment, was more effective than treatment as usual or some minimal intervention or some psychoeducation, whatever the control condition is, both following treatment and at follow-up time points across these studies. For substance use, they found no differences immediately at the end of treatment, but when they looked at follow-up time points, particularly 5 or 7 months later, the people who had gotten trauma-focused treatment were more likely to have better substance use outcomes than the people who didn't. But they found that people were more likely to drop out of the trauma-focused treatment than they were to drop out of the treatment as usual, standard care kind of conditions. So turning now to the coping skills therapy, it just so happened that every study that Cochrane identified used the same protocol, which is called seeking safety. And the model of seeking safety is that you shouldn't do exposure. You don't need to talk about the trauma. You don't need to think back on the trauma. You do need to kind of understand how it's making you make poor coping choices now and then work on coping better. And it teaches, every session teaches a different coping skill. So relaxation skills, kind of behavioral things like good self-care, interpersonal skills like deciding if someone's a safe person for you or if there's someone who's dragging you down to use, getting your needs met in relationships, cognitive skills, you know, what are sort of your slippery slope for relapse and things like that. So it really focuses on skills for the here and now, but no trauma processing. And what Cochrane found was the 7 or so studies compared to, you know, standard care or control conditions, there were no differences between the conditions on PTSD symptoms or substance use symptoms compared to treatment as usual across these 7 studies. Some people who used the full seeking safety protocol, which is like 26 sessions, most of the studies used fewer than that, did see some differences post-treatment. By follow-up a few months later, they looked the same as the comparable to the control condition again. On the upside, there wasn't higher dropout rates for seeking safety than for the control conditions, whereas we did see higher dropouts for the trauma-focused conditions. So their takeaway points were that really dropout was high across all the studies, whether or not they were the control conditions, seeking safety, trauma-focused. This research is really plagued by high dropout. And as a meta-analysis, they concluded that the quality of this research is low to very low. And what that means is that we don't expect these findings to be stable, that as we do more studies and get more data, because the data is so limited and flawed at this point with the dropout and such, that this pattern of findings that I just presented might change. So I thought this was really a good jumping off point because it really begs the question of where do we go next in this field to treat this very difficult, struggling, and highly prevalent comorbid population. So clear, you know, what became pretty apparent in the Cochrane review was that we actually don't have studies that compare trauma-focused directly to coping skills, right? They looked at trauma-focused compared to treatment as usual, and they looked at coping skills compared to treatment as usual. But we really need studies that actually do a head-to-head comparison. So I'll talk about where we are with that. And then they excluded, I believe, only one study that included a medication. And of course, everyone here who treats this comorbidity knows that in clinical practice, we're usually offering both medication and behavioral intervention. They excluded it because they weren't including medication, but they only had to exclude one study at that point. There are more studies now. Dr. Petrakis has both run some of those studies and actually has a review coming out soon that I'll only spoil a little bit that reviews those studies. But there's very, There's few that are of medication only, and there's even fewer of behavioral therapy with medication, even though really in clinical practice that's probably the most common. And what strikes me as one of the most glaring pieces is that when we see a severe SUD, a veteran or a client in any setting who has severe SUD, it's very common for them to get residential care or intensive outpatient care. I think the data is something like 30 to 40% of people with an SUD at some point are at a severity level where they get a higher level of care. And here we are talking about this incredibly complex population with comorbid PTSD that's so treatment resistant, and yet all these studies have been outpatient. These are all primarily studies where people got therapy once a week. So are we looking at the wrong level of care? I think that's the other really important question we need to be asking ourselves. So let's break each of these down a little bit further. So in terms of studies comparing trauma-focused and coping skills therapies, that is a study that we have in progress, exactly that, comparing PE. And it's a PE protocol developed by Sudi Beck that also includes some relapse prevention for substance use disorder. So it's an integrated protocol of exposure and some substance use disorder intervention. And we're comparing it to Seeking Safety. And so what I'm showing you is a paper that is sort of a methods paper because we have four more people to recruit. So we're at the very end of in a year I will have data to show, and that is so exciting. But right now I'll tell you more about what we're doing and what we're hoping to answer. So we're comparing this COPE protocol, PE plus relapse prevention, to Seeking Safety. And we're offering 12 to 16 weeks of therapy, depending on the patient's needs. And we're predicting that both will show reduction in alcohol use because they're both getting great alcohol use intervention and other substance use intervention. But we're hypothesizing that the group that gets PE, which is one of our most effective treatments for PTSD, will do better in terms of PTSD symptoms. And we're expecting to see this at 3 and 6 month follow-up. But as we get further out from the treatment and follow-up, we're also expecting to see that the group that gets PE will do better in regard to alcohol use. We are taking a page from Dr. Crystal's playbook and many of you here in terms of really thinking in terms of the biological mechanisms and how they contribute to treatment outcome and not just limiting ourselves to these primary outcomes regarding psychotherapy. And so one of the things my colleagues and I are interested in is sleep. And there's some research suggesting that disrupted REM sleep in particular really disrupts fear circuitry and may make safety learning and more difficult. And so we're actually hypothesizing that people with worse sleep may do worse in the PE condition. And we're measuring this both by having them wear actigraphy watches for a week before and after treatment and also by doing polysomnography on a small part of that sample. And then a colleague of mine was able to get a CDA so that we're able to look at some potential brain structures in terms of, or brain functions in terms of what predicts response to treatment and what might change in response to treatment, both for PTSD symptoms and for alcohol use. And so Andrew Spadoni and Alan Simmons in San Diego have developed tasks that are really what they're interested in is in anticipation. So participants are in a scanner, and they know if they see a certain color and sound that they'll see a neutral picture, and if they see a different color and sound, they're going to see something that might provoke their PTSD symptoms or might be a beer and maybe trigger a craving. And so after people are trained in the task, they look at the anticipation and what happens in the brain differently if they're anticipating something neutral versus something that'll trigger cravings or symptoms. So we'll be able to inform that a little bit. And her specific hypotheses are that greater brain response during aversive anticipation and alcohol cue response at baseline will correlate with smaller treatment effects on PTSD symptoms and percentage of drinking days at treatment end. And that PE relative to seeking safety will show greater decreases during aversive anticipatory stress and alcohol cue reactivity relative to baseline brain response. And finally, we're getting some saliva samples on our participants, and my colleague Vicky Risbrow is really interested in this VALMET allele that apparently there's some animal and healthy human evidence that people who have this allele also, their fear extinction and safety learning processes might not be as good. And so she's proposing that people who have that also won't do as well in the COPE condition. So again, this is our effort to sort of go beyond just the primary outcomes, because as we saw in the Cochrane review, the primary outcomes are not impressive, and we need to be pushing harder to really understand who's getting better, who's not, and why. And so we're trying to look at it from as many directions as we can. So, you know, the other thing I mentioned is here we are all prescribing medication and behavioral therapy, and yet so few of our studies have done that. Most, if not all, have only looked at alcohol use disorders. And the findings have really been mixed around medications. If there is a pattern, it's possibly that the pattern that's looked at PTSD medications, like an SSRI, have found more helpfulness for PTSD than the alcohol use disorder, and ones that have used an alcohol medication, like naltrexone, have been more helpful to alcohol use than the PTSD symptoms. Not stunningly exciting, right? And that there are a couple of medications that seem to show promise for targeting both. Dr. Petrakis is studying some of those, and my lab is interested in topiramate, so we're hoping to look at that, and I'll talk about that more in a second. And in particularly, where are these studies where we're looking at both? So one study that's probably the biggest published one to date that uses both is from Edna Foa's lab. Edna Foa developed prolonged exposure therapy, and she recruited a sample that had PTSD and an alcohol disorder and had four conditions. People were randomized to PE or naltrexone, PE or placebo, supportive counseling, which was just talking to a really positive nurse who helped you, like, problem solve how not to drink, with naltrexone or with placebo. Their dropout rate was 32%, which is pretty standard for this procedure. And I'll walk you, don't even try to make sense of all of this, but throwing all these numbers at you to show you that most of them were not significant among any of these medication or therapy conditions. Here's what they found. That all the groups did a little better at post-treatment, right? Whether you got supportive therapy or PE, naltrexone or placebo, they did a little bit better, not significantly different from each other at post-treatment. A year later, the group that got PE and naltrexone had increased the least in how much they were drinking. So all groups had sort of regressed to drinking more. That group had increased the least. Call the press, right? I mean, and there was a trend that people who had gotten both were most likely to be in this category of having very low PTSD symptoms, that the other groups who'd gotten either PE or naltrexone or neither were more likely to have higher PTSD symptoms. So I think they cut themselves off a little bit in a way that we can learn from, in that they excluded most other substance dependents, and as those of us working with this population know, that excludes a lot of people and maybe gives you a somewhat limited sample. Excluded for opiates in the past month, which again excludes a lot of people these days. They required people to be drinking very heavily, but to agree to be abstinent at the beginning of treatment. And again, those of us working with the population knows that that'll cut off a lot of people. In our own studies, we use a harm reduction model. So we want people who say they want to cut down and they're willing to set goals to cut down, but we don't require them to be abstinent. So I think we'll get a more real-world sample as we have more studies coming out that are more inclusive. But it does suggest that PE and an anti-relapse medication is promising. And so we, our own direction is to look at topiramate, which has a really good effect size for alcohol use disorder, comparable to naltrexone probably in most studies. And mixed evidence on PTSD, some studies suggest that it actually might help some of the symptoms of PTSD as well. So we thought that was kind of an exciting medication. And it's one that has not yet been evaluated together with a behavioral treatment. So we're planning to do a study where everyone gets PE and then they're randomized to get naltrexone or placebo. I'll tell you about one more study and then we'll round up. But this is maybe the one I'm actually most excited about right now, this mismatch between this outpatient level of care that we're studying and this maybe higher level of care that these patients can benefit from. And if you think about it, we're addressing PTSD and alcohol and substance use disorder in such a varied number of settings. Primary care is where a lot of these patients present and where a lot of these patients stay, either because they're not referred or they don't want to be referred. General mental health, PTSD programs, and then residential programs, which are more intensive treatments. And then sometimes inpatient, but that's generally involuntary and more about stabilization than really recovery-oriented treatment. And so, as I mentioned, most of our studies have been at this outpatient level of care, either general mental health or specialty, but not at this residential treatment level. So we did some pilot work in San Diego in a substance use residential program where we offered people PE. And PE, even though we're seeing that it's fine and somewhat effective for people with a substance use disorder, people are still very wary to do it when people are residential because they're so acute when they're residential. They need this high level of care. They couldn't possibly handle a trauma-focused treatment. They couldn't possibly handle talking about their trauma memory. So that's what we wanted to test, is that belief true? So one other person has done this also at pilot work, and this is Scott Coffey's group in Mississippi, and they looked at a series of four case studies, and it was four people in sort of community-based residential settings, all with alcohol use disorder, all with non-veterans with traumas that, you know, ranging from car accidents to abuse. They had PTSD in the beginning, and then by post-treatment and 3 months later and 6 months later, they did not have PTSD. And in fact, if you are familiar with the PTSD literature, these are like stunningly low CAP scores post-treatment. Usually we do not see people heading to below 20 or down to zero. And so the fact that all four did by follow-up absolutely piqued my interest. So we wanted to kind of add to their pilot with our own pilot and look at this in a VA residential program, so a hospital-based program with veterans who'd been through combat and military sexual traumas. We expanded to all substance use disorders, not just alcohol. And we actually had a comparison condition. I wish the study were randomized. It's not. But what happened was I basically had study therapists from other studies and postdocs and grad students who really wanted to do therapy on the study. And we're really eager to do it. But what we were doing was offering on this residential substance use unit PE, the only way we could fit it in was to do it three times a week. So these are 90-minute sessions, three times a week with prep. So most of these trainees and therapists only had the bandwidth to take one patient. They were really enthusiastic about it and really wanted the one patient, but just couldn't take more. So basically, if a patient came in who fit our criteria and was willing to do this, and we had a therapist available, they would get PE. If we didn't, they became our control group. And actually, we got some funding through a VA mechanism for this. That's very preliminary. It was called like a local project, and it was a very small pot of money. And all we promised was that we'd see two patients. And the unit really liked it. And I had the resources through other research to do this and through trainees. And so we actually kept going. We didn't stop at two patients. We have a sample, as you'll see, that's bigger than that. So we gave the PCL, PTSD measure, depression measure at baseline right before they discharged and 3 months later. Unfortunately, we don't have substance use outcomes. We gave them $10 coupons to use at the cafeteria or the store at the VA for filling out the questionnaires, and we gave them a treatment satisfaction questionnaire. The only thing to take from this slide is that they were really poly-substance using and using multiple substances. A lot were using alcohol, but as you can see, this adds up to much, much, much more than 100%. And what we saw was that for PTSD symptoms, they started pretty comparably, and the group that got PE did much was much lower by 20 points than the group that didn't. And what we were really interested in is what happens when they go back to their communities. Because if you think about it, this is a very chaotic population. And here they are coming to this program that's very comfortable. They have a bed. They have three meals a day. There's a lot of stress taken out of their lives. They start to feel safe. They have good social support. So we sort of expect distress measures to look better at the end. That doesn't mean that necessarily lasting recovery is occurring to me. It means that they're comfortable, which is wonderful. But to me, sort of the magic is what happens when they go back to their communities or are discharged from the program. So what we see 3 months later is that the group that that didn't get PE, their symptoms are sort of crawling back up. And the group that did get PE, their symptoms are continuing to crawl downward. And for depression, we see, again, that they look pretty comparable after the program. Great, they're both comfortable. They're both feeling a little less distressed. But we see this trend toward the group that didn't get PE symptoms growing up and these symptoms continuing to go down. Preliminary data, small sample, I don't want to overstate it, but enough to get me really excited to want to do a trial, a full-blown trial on this. We had zero dropouts, and so did Scott Coffey's group. And satisfaction was very high across both conditions because they liked the program, and so I don't think that's particularly telling. One of my therapists, we have in our VA above the elevators these announcements, and sometimes if a patient gives their therapist a compliment, it appears. So here we are standing at the elevator one day, and we see this quote, Dr. Brittany Davis has made a significant impact on my recovery from PTSD in just 6 weeks. She's professional, supportive, cheerful, very intelligent, and a credit to the VA and the field of psychology. This is someone who is incredibly difficult to work with, incredibly emotionally dysregulated. The other group leaders almost asked us to stop PE with her because she would get so agitated sometimes after her sessions with us when she talked about her trauma. And then she had the session where she had a really big turning point. And she still comes and visits us, and she's employed and abstinent and has a visitation with her daughter. So it's pretty amazing. So Scott Coffey published a paper making some recommendations from their pilot work. They did twice weekly PE and continued it in aftercare. They lend recorders and headphones to the patients to listen to sessions. And they help patients find time and space for the work because you don't have a lot of privacy on this unit and you kind of need privacy to do your PE homework. And they didn't really send people out in the community or anything. They really encouraged using the internet to find sounds and images to help people expose themselves to those things they've been avoiding. We couldn't necessarily continue in aftercare because some people came from other parts of the country to our program. So what we did instead was we did PE 3 times a week and occasionally got extensions. And we did send people all over the hospital, up and down the elevator to crowded waiting rooms. We sent them across the bridge to the university. We sent one woman out to the dumpsters who the smell of garbage was one of her triggers. So we found that the setting around the hospital was really ripe for doing these kinds of exposures. And we really found that if we didn't have the buy-in of the other treatment providers, we were dead in the water. Some were easy to bring around. Some really needed to see how transformative it was for some of their patients. But we really needed that support of the unit to pull it off. So this is possible to do, and it's promising. And I'd really like to do an RCT on it sometime soon. So to close, I've said this before, it's a frustrating time for those of us studying this and certainly those living with this and treating this. You know, our treatment gains are modest, our dropout is high, but on the other hand, it's an exciting time. We have promising directions and multiple promising directions. Things we thought were unsafe and not okay, we know are now safe and effective, and so we just have to figure out how to make them more effective. And we still have so many unexplored directions. So, thank you.